वेलकम टू दी सेशन ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्टेशन इंजीनियरिंग टू। इन दिस क्लास विल बी डूइंग रिवीजन ऑन यूनिट टू एंड विल बी सीइंग व्हाट आर द इम्पोर्टेंट क्वेश्चन दैट कैन बी आस्क फ्रॉम यूनिट टू। सो बेसिकली यूनिट टू रिवीजन, इन यूनिट टू रिवीजन एज वी नो दैट इन Unit 2 mainly comprises of Unit 2 is all about problems, numerical problems, and we have discussed those numerical problems in geometric numericals on videos, geometric numericals on geometric design 1, numericals on geometric design 2, numericals on geometric design 3. So we can see those things in numericals on geometric design 1, 2 and 3. The videos are on the YouTube, and this session we will be discussing about theoretical answers which are expected. Generally those numericals can be asked in the part B for 5 marks or for 10 marks. Okay, now I'll be saying theoretical based question, as we have done with numericals. We'll be saying theoretical based questions in this session. So let us see what are the important questions from unit 2. These are the important questions from unit 2. These following are the important questions from unit 2. The questions are as follows: what is left hand turnout and what is right hand turnout? The first question. The next question is, draw a neat diagram of layout of turnout and explain the important components of turnout. The third question is, write about different types of gradients used in railways. And the fourth question is, what is the necessity of geometric design? The fifth question is, what are the elements of circular curve and write about the different methods for setting out a circular curve. The next question, what is super elevation? What are its functions? Write about negative super elevation. What is super elevation? Write about negative super elevation. What is transition curve? Requirement of an idle transition curves and type of transition curves. Write in detail about widening of gauge on curves. Then next is what are vertical curves? And the last question is, what are crossing? Classify different types of crossings. So these are nothing but important questions from unit 2. Just have a look. Left hand turnout, right hand turnout, neat diagram of a turnout, gradients used in railways, geometric design, circular curve, super elevation, negative super elevation, transition curve, widening of gauges on curves, vertical curves and crossings. So now let us go to the question 1 and answer that. So the question is, what is left hand turnout and what is right hand turnout? Generally, what is left hand turnout? When we talk about left hand turnout and right hand turnout, the diagrams are important. The diagrams in this perspective is important for left hand turnout and right hand turnout. The diagrams are of much more important. So what is left hand turnout? The train from main track is diverted to the left of the main route in the facing direction. In the facing direction, see, now we need to look. This is nothing but, this side is nothing but facing direction. This is nothing but facing direction. This is nothing but trailing direction. Okay, so what is the definition of left hand turnout? Train from main track, okay, train from main track is diverted to the left of the main route in the facing direction. When we talk about facing direction, this is nothing but facing direction. Here we have facing direction. From here, this is nothing but our main track. Okay, this main track is diverted to the left, is nothing but left hand turnout. Similarly, right hand turnout, from the facing direction, if it is directed, train from the main track is diverted to the right of the main route in the facing direction, is nothing but right hand turnout. Generally this can be asked for 2 or 3 marks mainly. So So these two definitions are not enough. We need to support our this one line with the following diagram. The diagram need not be that much complex, but a basic components of a turnout has to be drawn in this diagram. This is all about left hand turnout and right hand turnout. What is left hand turnout and what is right hand turnout? Alone just definitions will be not sufficient. We need to draw the diagram. This much complex diagram, if you are unable to draw, no problem, but you need to support this answer with a diagram. And in the diagram, this facing direction, trailing direction, these directions are important. You need to mark, this is facing direction, this is trailing direction. Here also, it is facing direction, it is trailing direction. This directions you need to mark. So let us go back to our next question. Our next question is nothing but draw a neat diagram of layout of a turnout and explain important components of turnout. This question is usually important for 5 or 10 marks. Sometimes this question can be directly given for 10 marks also. Draw a neat diagram of layout of a turnout and explain important components of a turnout. Generally this question is asked in part B. If it's asked in part A, just a definition is required. If this question is asked for 2 marks, just this diagram of turnout has to be drawn and we need to write this component parts. That's it. But if it's for 5 or 10 marks, we need to elaborate this whole thing in detail. So let us start this answer. Draw a new diagram of a layout of a turnout and explain important components of turnout. Turnout. First, let us see the definition of turnout. Simple arrangement of points and crossing by the manipulation of which the train from one track may be diverted to another track or branch line or to a sliding is known as turnout. See, this is nothing but definition of turnout. This definition is important. Simple arrangement of points and crossing by the manipulation of which the train from one track may be diverted to the another track or branch line or to sliding is known as a turnout. Two tracks either merge or diverge, or two tracks parallel to each other but are still connected to each other. This connection helps in changing the direction of trains. For this, points and crossings are used. So this is nothing but diagram of a turnout, constituents of a turnout. Important. Without diagram, this answer is not at all accepted. Without diagram, this answer is not at all accepted. This is nothing but facing direction. We'll talk from a facing direction. Okay. The important components are nothing but see through or switch, tongue rail, check rail. Here we have nose, wing rail, throat, okay, stretch bar, stock rail, nose of a crossing, theoretical nose of crossing, actual nose of crossing. Generally, these are important points of a turnout. After drawing this diagram, we need to explain the constituents parts in detail. So let us start. Components parts of a turnout. The first is a pair of tongue rails. Second, a pair of stock rails. This all you can find it in this diagram. Stock rails are over here. We have tongue rails over here. Stock rails, tongue rails, so pair of tongue rails, a pair of stock rails, two check rails, four lead rails, a V crossing, slide chairs, stretch bar, a pair of heel blocks, switch type plate or gauge, parts for operating points, rods, cranks, levers, etc. locking system which include locking box, lock bar, plunge bar, etc. Generally this till here it is much more important components. These two are optional. When we start describing about this components of a turnout, I'll start just give the direction. What is nothing but facing direction, standing at a switch and looking towards a crossing, we get facing direction. Trailing direction, standing at a crossing and looking towards switches, we get trailing direction. Points, what are points? A pair of tongue rails with stock rails. Train diverting from the main track will negotiate this point first. Tongue rail, it is a tapered movable rail made up of high carbon or manganese steel to withstand wear. As it is thicker end, it is attached to a running rail. A tongue rail is also called as switch rail. Then we need to explain about stock rail. It is a running rail against which a tongue rail operates. Switch angle, angle between the gauge face of the stock rail and tongue rail at the theoretical toe of switch. Throw switch, when we talk about throw switch, dispense by which the tongue rail move laterally at the toe of a switch. Then we have crossing. Crossing is a device introduced at the junction where two rails cross each other to permit the wheel flange of a railway vehicle to pass from one track to another. Switches components. A set of points or switches consist of the following main constituents. Switches consist of a pair of stock rails and a pair of tongue rails. We have different types of switches. When we want to talk about types of switches, we have two types: stud switch, split switch. Switches are divided into two types of switches. Stud switch, split switch. Stud, split. Again, split is divided into two: loose heel type, fixed heel type. Loose heel type and fixed heel type. When we talk about crossing, crossing or frog is a device introduced at the point where two gauges face across each other to permit the flanges of a railway vehicle to pass from one track to another. So what is crossing? This crossing definition is important. A crossing or a frog is a device introduced at the point where two gauge face cross each other to permit the flange of a railway vehicle to pass from one track to another. A gap is provided from throw to the nose of crossing. Check rails assures the correct movement and guide the wheel properly. So this was all about turnout. This is the answer for draw any diagram and layout of turnout and explain important components. Some data you can eliminate. Suppose when we talk about types of switches, again we were explaining in deep about those switches, so those data you can eliminate if you find the length of answer is more, but other things are as same. The next question, write about different types of gradient using railways. We clearly know that gradients are nothing but undulations. Gradients, you can say the rise or fall is nothing but a gradient. Okay, so how many types of gradients used in Indian railway? Basically those are of four: ruling gradient, pusher or helper gradient, momentum gradient, gradient in station and yards. These are nothing but different type of gradient used in Indian railways. If the question is for 2 or 3 marks, just we need to mention 4 gradients. That's it. Name of 4 gradients: rolling gradient, pusher or helper gradient, momentum gradient or gradient in station and yards. If the same question is asked for 5 marks, we need to explain this 4 types of gradient in detail. We need to explain this 4 types of gradient in very much detail. So let us see what all we need to write. Let's go into detailing for 5 marks answer what we need to include. Ruling gradient. So when we talk about ruling gradient is the steepest gradient that exists in section. It determines the maximum load that can hauled by a locomotive or that section. Indian Railway does not specify any fixed ruling gradient owing to enormous variations in the topography of the country. Okay, thus these values are important. In the plain terrain, 1 in 150 to 1 in 250, these are nothing but maximum values. In hilly terrain, 1 in 100 or 1 in 150 will be the ruling gradient. The next we talk about pusher or helper gradient. Generally this happens in hilly areas. Pusher or helper gradient. One locomotive is not adequate. So what we do? We pull the entire load by an extra locomotive. So this type of gradient is nothing but pusher or helper gradient. The next is momentum gradient. In the momentum gradient, what we do is, in valleys, a falling gradient. In valleys, a falling gradient is sometimes followed by a rising gradient. In such situation, a train coming down a falling gradient acquires good speed and momentum, which gives additional kinetic energy to the train to allow it to negotiate gradients steeper than the rolling gradient. In this way, the momentum gradient is used. Then we have gradients in station or yards. The gradients in station and yards are quite flat due to the following reasons. To prevent standing vehicles from rolling and moving away from the yard due to the combined effect of gravity and strong winds. To reduce the additional resistive force required to start a locomotive to the extent possible. The maximum prescribed gradient in station yards on Indian Railways is 1 in 400, while recommended is 1 in 1000. These values are important. In the description thing. So this was all about gradients, type of gradients used in Indian Railways. If the question is for 2 or 3 marks, just we need to write the 4 names of this 4 gradients. If it's for 5 marks, we need to describe this 4 gradients in detail. Remember one thing, don't forget to mention these values in the description of these gradients. Our next question is about necessity of geometric design. What is the necessity of geometric design? This for sure, this question is asked for 2 or 3 marks. No chances of asking it for 5 marks. So we need to write about 5 to 6 necessities for geometric design. So what is the necessity for geometric design? The need of proper geometric design of a track arises because of the following consideration. To ensure smooth and safe running of trains, to achieve maximum speed, to carry heavy axial loads, to avoid accidents and derailments due to defective permanent way, to ensure that track requires least maintenance for good aesthetics. These are nothing but necessity for geometric design. This all has to be included for the answer for necessity of geometric design. Minimum 6 points has to be added. Necessity of geometric design thing. So let us go back to our next question. Our next question is about what are the elements of a circular curve and write about the different methods of setting a circular curve. Generally, elements of a circular curve, this question can be asked in 2 or 3 marks. This question is asked for the 2 or 3 marks thing. Elements of a circular curve. For this, the diagram is very much important. Without this diagram of elements of circular curve, the answer will not be valid. See, this diagram is very much important. Elements of circular curve. Many of you people in internal exam did not draw this exam, did not draw this diagram. Whenever the question is about circular curve, you need to draw what is circular curve. So, description. Elements are nothing but this only, tangent length. You need not describe, if it's for 2 or 3 marks, you need not describe this all in much in detail. If you are lazy enough to describe this, all those things, what you need to do? You need to draw this diagram and mention this part. Tangent length is nothing but r tan phi by 2. Length of the chord t1 t2 is nothing but 2r sin phi by 2. Length of curve 2 pi r by 360 into phi. That's it. These are nothing but elements of circular curve only. If it's for 5 marks, with this diagram, the explanation has to be given. The explanation should also be given. If it's for 5 marks. And different methods for setting out a circular curve: tangential offset method, long chord offset method, quartering of chord sine method, chord deflection method. You know, this question hasn't, this setting out methods were not asked in the exam, but to be safer side, we need to know with this methods. If you want description of this methods, it is in your notes. You can follow from that. Setting out a circular curve. So this was the answers related to elements of circular curve and methods for setting out a circular curve. Once again, this diagram is very much of important. So now let us go to our next question. That is nothing but what is super elevation, what are its functions. So what is super elevation, what are its functions? Super elevation or Cant, super elevation, the name of super elevation is nothing but Cant. Super elevation or Cant is the difference in height between the outer and the inner rail of a curve. Outer and inner rail of a curve. It is provided gradually lifting the outer rail above the level of inner rail. The inner rail is taken as a reference rail and is normally maintained at its original level. The inner rail is also known as gradient rail. And functions, when we talk about functions of super elevation, these are the following. The first function is to ensure better distribution of loads on both rails. Second function is to reduce wear and tear of the rails of rolling stock, rails and rolling stock. Third function is to neutralize the effect of lateral forces. Fourth, to provide comfort to passengers. This is nothing but the answer for super elevation thing. What is super elevation and what are its functions? This following answer can be written for the above question. What is super elevation and what are its functions? Okay, now let us move to our next question. Our next question is about negative super elevation. We need to answer question about negative super elevation. So let us see. So write about negative super elevation. This question can be asked for 2 or 3 marks. So what is negative super elevation? When the main line lies on a curve and has a turnout of a contrary flexure leading to a branch line, the super elevation necessary for the average speed of train running over the main line curve cannot be provided. AB, see, look at over here, AB, which is outer rail of the main line curve, must be higher than CD. This is obvious for normal super elevation thing. For the branch line, however, CF, look at our CF. CF should be what? Higher than AE. But what happens? Higher than AE or point C should be higher than point A. Done? In this case, when we talk about this, these two contradictory conditions cannot be met with one layout. In such cases, the branch line curve has a negative super elevation. Therefore, speed on both track must be restricted, particularly on the branch line. This diagram is very much important when we talk about negative super elevation. In the negative super elevation thing, if you don't talk about the diagram, it is not valid. You need to explain how A and C points, how it is higher and how it is lower. That has to be described in this thing. So this is the question for negative super elevation. At least you need to start mentioning from here AB, which is the outer rail. Diagram is very much important. Next question is about what is transition curve, requirements of an ideal transition curve and type of transition curve. What is transition curve? Requirements of an ideal transition curve and type of transition curves. Generally, this question will be asked for 5 marks. This can be asked in parts. What is transition curve? It can be asked for 2 marks. Or requirements of ideal transition curve, this can be asked for 2 marks. Or a type of transition curve, this can be asked for 2 marks or 3 marks. Or together, actual, this together question is for 5 marks, or else it can be asked in parts also. So the next question which we're going to see is what is transition curve, requirements of an ideal transition curve and type of transition curve. As I have explained it earlier, this question can be asked together as a whole, or this question can be divided into three, such as generally they can ask only what is transition curve definition,
और रिक्वायरमेंट्स ऑफ एन आइडियल ट्रांजिशन कर्व डेफिनेशन और टाइप्स ऑफ ट्रांजिशन कर्व थे. सो देर कैन बी ए वेरी डिफरेंट वेरिएशंस इन दिस आंसर क्वेश्चन. सो इफ द क्वेश्चन सो द क्वेश्चन फॉर वॉट इज ट्रांजिशन कर्व थिंग इज द ट्रांजिशन कर्व इज देर फोर द इज नथिंग बट the transition curve is in which the degree of curvature and the gain of super elevation are uniform. The transition curve is in which the degree of curvature and the gain of super elevation are uniform throughout its length, starting from zero at the target point to the specified value at a circular curve. This is nothing but definition of transition curve. What is definition of transition curve? Generally, the degree of curvature and the gain of super elevation are uniform throughout its length. This is mandatory. Degree of the curvature and the gain of super elevation are uniform throughout its length, starting from zero at the tangent point to the specified value at circular curve. And next, it is asking about requirements of transition curve. So, requirements of an ideal, what is requirement of an ideal transition curve? You can see on your screen. It is nothing but the transition curve should satisfy the following conditions. It should be tangential to the straight line of the track. It should be circular curve tangentially. The curvature should increase at the same rate as the super elevation. The length of transition curve should be adequate to attain the final super elevation, which increases gradually at a specified rate. These are nothing but requirements of an ideal transition curve. The above was the definition of transition curve, and this is nothing but definition of transition curve. Here, these were requirements of transition curve. When we talk about type of transition curve, here these are the various type of transition curves which you can see on your screen. Different type of transition curve. Cubic parabola, sine curve, spiral, Bernoulli, lemniscate. These are various different types of transition curve. Types of transition curves. These are the following. So, what is transition curve? Requirements of an ideal transition curve or types of transition curve. This all can be found out from this answer. Let us move to our next question, that is nothing but write in detail about widening of gauges on curves. Widening of gauges on the curve. For that we have one formula. This formula is important. Widening of gauges on different curves. We have this formula. This formula we need to write. This formula is very much important for this answer. Sometimes a problem can also be asked on this widening of gauge topic. So what is widening of gauge? A vehicle normally assumes the central position on a straight track and the flanges of the wheels stay clear on the rails. The situation, however, changes on a curved track. As soon as the vehicle moves onto a curve, the flange of the outside wheel of the leading axle continues to travel in a straight line till it rubs against the rail. Due to the coning of wheels, the outside wheel travels a longer distance compared to the inner wheel. This, however, becomes impossible for the wheel as a whole since the rigidity of the wheel base causes the trailing axle to occupy a different position. In an effort to make up the difference in the distance traveled by the outer wheel and the inner wheel, the inside wheel slips backwards and the outer wheel skids forward. A close study, the running of vehicle on curves indicate that wear of flanges eases the passage of the vehicle around the curve as it is effect of the increase in the gauge. The widening of the gauge on a curve, in fact, the same effect and tends to decrease the wear and tear on both wheels and the track. The widening of gauge can be given by this formula. Extra width on curve is equal to 13B plus L whole square by R, where B is nothing but wheel base. This has to be in meters. R is radius. This should be also in meters. L is nothing but the formula of L is 0.02 into h square plus dh to the power 1 by 2. Where h is nothing but lap of flange and d is nothing but depth of flange. L is the lap of flange, h is the depth of flange, and d is the diameter of the wheel base. This is all about widening of gauge on curves. Widening of gauge on curves. The formula is much important. Formula and this description, what B stands for, what L stands for, what R stands for, and what is the, again, what is in detail formula for L. This is important. Let us go to our next question. Our next question is about what are vertical curves. What are vertical curves? An angle is formed when the point of two different grades meets, forming a summit or a sag. The angle formed at the point of contact of the gradient is smoothened by providing a curve called vertical curve. In a vertical plane. In the absence of vertical curve, vehicles are likely to have a rough run on the track. Besides this, a change in gradient may also cause bunching of vehicles in the sags and a variation in tension of couplings in the summits, resulting in train parting and uncomfortable ride. See, generally, these are nothing but vertical curves, as you can see on your screens. The angle between rise and fall, it is termed as summit curves. The angle between fall and rise is generally nothing but sag curves. So we have two types of vertical curves. That is nothing but summit curves and sag curves. This is all about vertical curves. This was all about vertical curves. The diagram is important when we are describing the vertical curves. The diagram is important. Our last question is about what are crossings? Classify different types of crossings. What are crossings? Classify different types of crossings. Crossings. A crossing or frog is a device introduced at the point where two gauge faces cross each other to permit the flanges of a railway vehicle to pass from one track to another. A gap is provided from through to the nose of the crossing. Check rail assures the correct movement and guides the wheel properly.
this is nothing but till here this comes under definition of crossings. Then we have types of crossing. Based on shape of crossing, the crossing can be classified as acute angle crossing, obtuse angle crossing, right angle crossing. Based on assembly of crossing, it is classified as spring crossing, cross crossing, diamond crossing, scissor crossing, ladder track or gathering line. Here in acute angle crossing, or it is also termed as V crossing, two rail gauge faces cross at acute angle. Obtuse angle or diamond crossing, two gauges faces meet at obtuse angle. Square crossings, two track cross at right angle. These are few examples of crossing. See, this is nothing but scissor crossing. This you can see, it is nothing but scissor crossing. This is nothing but scissor crossing. This is nothing but crossover. This is nothing but diamond crossing. This is nothing but diamond crossing. So this was all about crossing.